Okay. Well, as I just said, if you look around the world today and you listen to the leadership, and then after you've heard all their promises, you sit back and you think the only thing we hear is lies and the only thing we see is deceit. But a lot of lies have been made some 2,000 years ago in the intertestamental period between the Tanakh and the Brit Hadashah, in particular in relation to women. And we know, of course, the story that the woman, she sinned, and because she sinned, she had to pay the price in childbirth, and she had to be submissive to her husband. And this kind of teaching has affected women up until today in a very dramatic way. You have to understand from the scriptures that Yahweh created mankind, male and female, after his image. And this deception, as I will show you this morning, was purely created by Bible translators, and they translated the scriptures to suit that theology, to oppress or depress or put women in a lesser spot. And I'm going to prove this to you from the scriptures by showing you where the changes are and what in fact the biblical position of women is. And why am I doing this? Because the message to me at Shavuot was very clear, and that message was exactly the same as the message that the apostles were preaching at that time in the book of Acts chapter 2, where it says that you are to repent, you are to be baptized in the name of Yeshua, and then the Ruach will come to raise up our dead bones and make us come alive again. And men need to listen to this and repent from it if they have adopted, either knowingly or unknowingly, this theology of false institutionalized religion, who made this up, as I said, in the intertestament period. And women, I hope that it will liberate you and put you in the place where Yahweh wants you to be. Do I want to be controversial? No. Do I want to tell the truth? Yes. So therefore, I am dealing with this, not to stir up any trouble, but to be able to set right scripturally, because we are to teach the whole counsel of Yahweh. And in this study, and I've studied this quite thoroughly, I have used as a basis the book which is called Elohim's Word, or God's Word to Women, which is written by a lady called Catherine C. Bushell. The book is still available. If you go on to Amazon, you can still buy it. And she was a very well educated lady. She was a doctor. She was fluent in Hebrew and Greek. And she made it her life work to expose this conspiracy, if you like, that was made against women by these leaders. She quotes in her book many sources, most of them deliberately male sources, so that people don't say, "Oh well, they're only women, and you know, you can't take them serious." Catherine C. Bushell, God's Word to Women. And I've checked her sources, and I've checked thoroughly all the claims that she makes. She, of course, is or was a Christian, and therefore in her book she will not write it from a messianic perspective and uses positions that are purely Christian, which of course which we today would not agree with. But that is more in her general belief rather than in the specifics. We know from the scriptures in Genesis 2 verse 15, because this conspiracy of course goes back all the way to the Garden of Eden. And we see in Genesis 2:15, and Yahweh Elohim took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to guard it. Underline the word that he is to guard the garden of Yahweh, where Yahweh put him. That's the responsibility of the man, to guard the garden. What was Adam's job? To guard and protect the garden. But from whom is the question? The word protect is the Strong's word 8104, Shomer. It's like we have in Deuteronomy chapter 19, Shomer, the month of Aviv, guard it. In other words, you have to be in protection of it and guard this garden. He was not just to sit there and sit in the sun and get a suntan. He was to work it, guard it and protect it. And then we know from Genesis 2 verse 22, where it says in our English translations that Yahweh Elohim made a woman from the rib he had taken from the man. And I put underneath there, true or false. That's number one. Is this statement true or false? Well, I'm telling you that the statement is false. And I learned this many years ago when I went to study comparative religions at Massey University in Palmerston North. And when we came to this, this lecturer taught me, or asked the students there, that this was false. That the Hebrew is very specific as to how women were created. And when he told me, or told us the whole biblical account, I went to the minister and I said to him, excuse me friend, I just learned today from Mr. So-and-so at Massey University that the account of the creation of women is X, Y, and Z. He said, I know that. I said, you know that? I said, then why don't you teach that? Why do you stick to the story of the rib? Well, of course, that was very controversial. Anyway, the word rib, we find it in a couple of places. First one is Genesis 2 verse 21. So Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall on the man, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. And another one we have in Daniel chapter 7 verse 5. It says, and see another beast, a second, like a bear, and was raised up on one side and had three ribs. Exactly the same word. Ribs, Genesis 2:21, and ribs in Daniel 7 verse 5. The word is the Strong's word 6763. Salah. Genesis 2 verse 22, the word rib is the Hebrew word Salah, Strong's 6763. And as you can see, the main meaning of it there is site or chamber. 42 times the word translated in Genesis 2 verse 22 as rib is found in the Tanakh or in the Old Testament. In the majority of the cases it has been translated with site or sites or chamber. Only in Genesis 2:21 and 22 is it translated rib. Only in Genesis 2:21-22 is it translated with rib, whereas in all other cases this is translated with side. Salah is side. And in Daniel chapter 7 verse 5, it is the Strong's word 5967, Allah or rib. So a rib is an Allah and a side is Salah. But in relation to the creation of the woman, they have used the rib. rib or side. There it comes from the original interlinears. Allah is rib and Salah is side. Correctly translated in the Stone's edition of the Tanakh, and he took one of his sides and filled it in the flesh in its place. So it's the Stone's Tanakh has its right. So where does the story of the rib come from? And in the book written by Mr. F. Warren under the ISBN number 11507-33624, we have one of many explanations that you can find on the internet. So I've only given you a number of sources instead of 30 or 40 to prove a point. And the story of the rib by Rabbi Joshua, and that is not Joshua or Yeshua HaMashiach, but a rabbi by the name of Joshua. And he says, Elohim deliberated from what member he would create woman. And he reasoned with himself thus, I, that is Yahweh, must not create her from Adam's head, for she would be a proud person. Does that mean that Adam is proud? And hold her head high. If I create her from the eyes, then she will wish to pry into all things. If from the ear, she will wish to hear all things. And if from the mouth, she will talk much. If from the heart, she will envy people. And if from the hand, she will desire to take all things. If from the feet, she will be a gogabout. Therefore, I will create her from a member which is hid, that is the rib, which is not even seen when man is naked. One of the sources of the story of the rib, because Eve was created from the side of the Adam, and the Adam is the human. So Yahweh created a human, and he cut that human right in half. One side became male, and the other side became female. Not a rib, but a side. The rib is, according to Rabbi Joshua, amongst many others. And then what the rabbis did, they created a theology called the Ten Curses of Eve. According to these rabbis, Yahweh made 10 curses of Eve. Eve was cursed because she ate of the fruit. The first is menstruation, when she is driven from the house and banned from her husband. The second is to give birth after 9 months. The third is that she must nurse the child for 2 years. The fourth is that her husband rules over her. And the fifth is that he is jealous of her if she speaks with another man. And the sixth, she ages quickly. The seventh, that she ceases to give birth while men are always able to make children. The eighth is that she stays in the home and does not show herself in public like a man. And the ninth is that when she goes out into the marketplace, her head needs to be covered. Nowhere do I read it in the Torah, but here is where the head covering comes in, right? Her head needs to be covered. That's why a woman perceived the bear saying, we have brought death upon all the inhabitation of the world. The tenth is that she was upright. If she was upright, her husband would bury her. Now, there are various variations of these 10 curses. Some write them this, some write them that. And the next example of these 10 curses come from Rabbi Parki, the Rabbi Eliezer. And as you can see, they are virtually the same, although there might be variances here and there. So these men dreamt up these curses because nowhere, as I will show you in the Torah, can they be found. So that is a deliberate theology against women. Now you must say, you know, rabbis are bad people, right? Well, that can be said. But the Christian church fathers took over these 10 curses verbatim, and I will show you right up and inclusive of Martin Luther what they had to say, which is not very nice. Here's another selection of the 10 curses of Eve by Rabbi Isaac Ben Abdimi. These are the sources where I have taken this from, and I've only selected 3 out of many. So let's have a look at Eve and the position of the Christian church or the Christian church fathers. Tertullian, who lived in the 2nd and 3rd century, is one of the main corporates from which all the others took their cue. Tertullian, one of the early church fathers, wrote, "In pain shall you bring forth children, woman, and you shall turn to your husband, and he shall rule over you." What's this word, turn? "And do you not know that you are Eve? Elohim's sentence hangs still over you and all your sex, and his punishments weighs down upon you. You are the devil's gateway. You are she who first violated the forbidden tree and broke the law of Elohim. It was you who coaxed your way around him whom the devil had not the force to attack." In other words, the devil could not attack Adam, therefore he took Eve because she's much weaker and so on. See? "With what ease you shattered the image of Elohim. Man, because of the death you merited, even the son of Elohim had to die. Woman, you are the gate to hell." What do you think of that? That's one of your church fathers. John Chrysostom, he was called the preacher with the golden mouth. Revered in Christendom at the time, 347 to 407. Commanded every Christian father to instill into his son a resolute spirit against womankind. Let him have no converse with any woman save only his mother. Let him see no woman. Clement of Alexandria. Every woman should be filled with shame by the thought that she is a woman. Tertullian, same guy we quoted before, 1160 to 20. "Woman is a temple built over a sewer, the gateway to the devil. Women, you are the devil's doorway. You led astray one whom the devil would not dare attack directly. It was your fault that the son of Elohim had to die. You should always go in mourning and rags." Now, the consequences of all this are still valid today. Saint, in brackets, Ambrios. So these were the men of God of their time. Yeah? Remember, I say the men of God and not the men of Yahweh. They were the men of God, right? Exactly. Adam was deceived by Eve, not Eve by Adam. It is the right that he whom the woman induced to sin should assume the role of guide, lest he fall against through feminine instability. Augustine, 354 to 430. "Woman was merely man's helpmate, a function which pertains to her alone. She is not the image of Elohim, but as far as man is concerned, he is by himself the image of Elohim." Right? So the man is in the image of Elohim. That's why you must be under, as a woman, you must be under his covering. And if you are a nice, virtuous woman and do as you're told, right, you might be saved through his headship. All right? Pope Gregory, 540 to 604. Woman is slow in understanding, and her unstable and naive mind renders her by way of natural weakness to the necessity of a strong hand in her husband. Her use is twofold, sex and motherhood. Well, thank you very much, Pope Gregory. And so we can quote Thomas of Aquinas, and then we get a little bit closer to home to John Knox, the great Presbyterian of Scotland. Woman was made for one reason only, to serve and obey men. And the great John Wesley, the Methodist, wife, be content to be insignificant. What loss would it be to Elohim or man had you never been born? And then we'll jump to Martin Luther, 1483 to 1546. The leading reformer, he says, if woman became tired or even die, that does not matter. Let them die in childbirth. That is why they are there. These are the leaders of Judaism and the Christian Church. And the consequences of these statements and the misinterpretation deliberately of the creation account has had great consequences and have put women under the thumbs of men to such a degree that it has created much misery in man and wife's relationship. Who or what was cursed? Who or what was cursed? Eve? Was she cursed, or who or what? What then was said to Eve by Yahweh in Genesis 3 verse 12? Yahweh said, "What is it that you have done?" And Eve replied, "The serpent thoroughly deceived me, and I did eat." And if you read the account in Genesis 3 verse 12, you see that Eve does not receive from Yahweh a "because you have done this." Right? She transgressed the Torah by deception. She was thoroughly deceived. To the serpent, Yahweh said, because you have done this, you are cursed above all cattle. And to Adam he said, and let's be very clear, Adam was not deceived. He knew exactly what he was doing, because the command from the tree you shall not eat was given to Adam before Eve was created. So Adam knew exactly what's going on, and he is standing there next to his wife, and this angel of light appeared to Eve, and he deceived her. Nowhere do we read in the Torah that Adam said, "Excuse me, dear, Yahweh told me precisely that we should not eat from this. Don't touch it. Don't do it, because we're going to get into trouble." He didn't do that. He just stood there and he said nothing. And then later he blamed Yahweh and he says, "The woman that you gave me, she did it." To Adam he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree, cursed is the ground for your sake." So, for whose sake is the ground of this earth cursed? For Adam's sake. Who's the other one cursed here in this account? The devil, right? Is there any curses here in this whole account given to Eve? The teaching teaching that Yahweh has cursed Eve and through Eve all women comes over in the theology from the Babylonian Talmud. It's not to be found anywhere in scripture, but it's a man-made theology. What does Yahweh say? Who does find a capable? That word capable in most of your translations is translated virtuous. See, a virtuous, nice, subjective woman who disobeys her husband, right? But I'm going to give you the Hebrew word of this, which will give you exactly what this means. Who does find a capable wife, for she is worth more than rubies? A woman who fears Yahweh is to be praised. Do you praise your wives, husbands, because your wife believes in Yahweh? A capable wife is a crown of her husband. Truly I say to you, the scripture says, wherever this good news of the gospel of Yahweh is proclaimed in all the world, what this woman has done shall be spoken of also in her remembrance. That's Mary Magdalene, one of the Marys who came to anoint Yeshua's feet. And he said to the woman, your belief or your faith has saved you, not your husband. You see, there is no such thing as that the woman is going to be saved through her husband. No, the woman is going to be saved by grace through faith, which is the free gift of Yahweh. Husband, respect your wives, because if you don't, 1 Peter 3 verse 7 says, then Yahweh will not hear your prayers. In the same way, husbands, live understandingly together, giving respect to the wife as to the weaker vessel and as being heirs together of the favor of life. Heirs together of the favor of life, so that your prayers are not hindered. So how should this relationship then be? Okay, we've got Yahweh here, we've got the man and the woman, and we need to set up a covenantal relationship between the husband and the wife and Yahweh, who says that I've created you equally, male and female, in my image. And I don't care what any preacher says, that only the man is created in the image of Yahweh and not the woman. That's a lie. Absolute lie. It shows you that that institution is devious and definitely not an institution of Yahweh. Let's have a look at this virtuous woman. Who can find a virtuous woman, says all your translations. Virtuous is the Hebrew word chayil. Virtuous means a positive trait of quality deemed to be morally good. Is that the quality that is only required, and is that the quality that is only portrayed in the Torah and the Tanakh of Yahweh in relation to women? We're going to look at that in a minute. Chayil, the Strong's word 2428. The first word that it renders is a force. The woman is to be a force, strength like an army, wealthy, virtue, valor, strength, able, activity, army, band of men, soldiers, a company, and so on and so on and so on. And then just about the end we have virtuous. So what's this trying to say? Virtuous, Strong's 2428, chayil, wealth, virtue, valor, and strength. The Syriac text, strong, powerful, and virile. So if we take it in the context of Ruth chapter 3 verse 11, all the city of my people know that thou art a virtuous or a chayil woman. Could she possibly have been called a woman of might, power, and valor? Proverbs 31 verse 10. Who can find a virtuous woman? for the price is far above rubies. We're going to read that chapter in a minute because it's very important. The word virtuous does not represent the teaching of the original text. And it should be noted that the only time the word is translated virtuous is when it refers to women. This appears to be a deliberate move by the translators to impose their concept of what a woman should be upon the text. So you have to remember that these men made all these statements and claims. Now they come to translate the scriptures. And I will show you how deliberately they have mistranslated the scriptures in relation to women, including in the New Testament when it comes to women being apostles. And what they did, they changed their names and gave them male names. So they appear to be male rather than female. A Chagil woman. Let's read Proverbs chapter 31. Most men read this at the beginning of the Sabbath. My translation says, a wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it is still dark. She provides foods for her family and portions for her servant girls. She considers a field and she buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants vineyards. She set about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable. This is just not a woman who just only is allowed to wash the dishes, is it? This lady is buying fields and plant and setting up vineyards and trading profitably. And her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand she holds a distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for the bed. She's clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat amongst the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, and her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but the woman who fears Yahweh is to be praised. Given her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gates. That's one of the biblical definitions of a woman, which is a totally different picture than the leadership of institutionalized religion gave us about 10 minutes ago. Next question. And he will rule over you. True or false? And he will rule over you. In other words, You come home, you make a steam. If he asks for his slippers, you bring them. You are virtuous, you are subservient, you do as you're told, because you ate from the apple and Adam is glorified. He blamed Yahweh and said, the woman that you gave me, she did it, right? And in the theology of man, Adam gets the top job, right? Because he never said anything, he never did anything. Who was the God, the garden? Why didn't Adam kick out this devil and says, I'm in charge in this garden, I am the God of here? Why didn't he move him out? But in the theology of man, he gets the top job, and the women shall they rule over. True or false? False. Genesis chapter 3:16. It reads in English, and your desire, the word teshuga, is for your husband, and he does rule over you. I'm going to show you a chart of this word teshuga. And it shows you that in all the translations, up until the later ones, when the rabbis started to come up with this theology, that word teshuga is translated turning. Not desire, turning. Now there's a big difference between turning and desire, right? Okay. How it should read, and I'll go through each of the words, is this. Thou art turning away to thy husband, and he will rule over you. But it is translated, and thy desire shall be to the husband, and he shall rule over you. The Hebrew word teshuga means a turning back and forth, a turning to. The inference here is, you are turning, or your turning will be to your husband rather than to Yahweh. In other words, Eve, we went through this whole saga with this thing here. Now, if you are going to turn away from me, Yahweh, but you are going to instead turn to your husband, right? He's going to rule over you. You have a choice. You either stay with Yahweh, yeah, here in the garden, or you go out with your husband, or you follow your husband. I'm going to show this to you. Thou art turning away from Yahweh towards your husband, and therefore he will rule over you. In other words, if you don't take your cue from me, Yahweh, but you're going to follow your husband, he will dominate you and rule over you. That's exactly what happened. The word teshuga is translated as desire in Genesis 3:16, Genesis 4:7, Songs of Solomon 7:10. 3:16, and your teshuga is for your husband, and he does rule over you. And his teshuga is for you, but you should master it. And I am my beloved's, and his teshuga is towards me. See, that's in relation to Messiah. We got to turn to the Messiah and not to the world. In the LXX, which is the Septuagint, the Septuagint is the Hebrew Tanakh being translated before the Christian era by 70 translators. So these 70 translators translated the whole of the Tanakh before Yeshua came into Greek. And these LXX translators, they translated this word correctly. They attempted to clarify their understanding of the term teshuga by translating it with the word, that's the Greek word, apostrophe, meaning turn away or to turn toward. So if we apply this to Genesis 4:7, Cain is turning towards his own motivation, ignoring Elohim's clear instructions, exactly what his father did. Turning towards their own motivation, or doing what they think is best rather than what Yahweh commanded. So if we read the word Teshuvah in the Septuagint, then it reads, then it reads like it is there in blue. But there's also, apart from that, another translation stream arising through the Syriac Peshitta and the Coptic translations. And this stream views the rare Hebrew word Teshuvah as turning and definitely not lust. Other translations later translate this word desire into the lust shall be after your husband. If this stream is correct, then the word in Genesis 3:16 is about Eve's mistake of turning her principal devotion towards Adam rather than to Elohim. That's the context. If you follow your husband instead of Yahweh, your desire shall be for your husband and he shall rule over you. Then the word shall is an imperative and a command word in English. The word in Hebrews, brew, is will, which simply tells of the future in the case of consequences of an action. Many recent translators have changed to will, but the damage done by considering these verses a command cannot be measured. Therefore, the word desire should be translated turning. You will turn to or reach out after your husband instead of Yahweh, and when you do, he will rule over you. Here's this chart. The chart is actually in two pages, but I can only put one page at a time. So there's another piece onto it, which I'll show you in a minute. And it shows you that the word Teshuvah in all these translations are the same, translated turning, until we come to, you see, Wycliffe and all these others, the later translations, and then it's translated desire and lust. So in this intertestamental period, this is all being developed. Then the Mishnah and the Gemara or the Talmud was written, and they took it all out of there, and then the early Christian fathers took this over verbatim, and there all the words are changed in these various translations. It is done absolutely deliberately, without any question, with grave consequences. Pain and sorrow. You see, because you ate from this tree, when you give childbirth, it has to hurt. That's your punishment. Isn't that what they taught you? I will greatly multiply your pain, the Hebrew word atzaf, in childbearing. In pain, atzaf, you will bring forth children. And then you see in the same verse that the same word is applied to Adam. And to Adam he said, cursed is the ground because of you. In atzaf you shall eat of it all the days of your life. There is toil, but for you it's pain. Right? Okay. Pain, atzaf. What it should be translated is that the one that was laying in wait has increased your sorrow, and in the same sorrow you will raise children. Laying in wait, referring to the devil. The one laying in wait has increased your sorrow, and in the same sorrow you will raise children. Because if we would have realized Adam and Eve and had never sinned, then our children would not have gone through this fallen state. The word asaf has the root meaning of labor or toil, or giving of oneself
of a work.
I'm getting so excited, even my recorders are going all over the place. Right. This is a wonderful definition of the process of carrying and giving birth to and raising children, which is uniquely a mother's role. But the word and its derivation, what it derives of, holds no implication of pain or physical sense, in the physical sense. And only of sorrow in a secondary sense. But correctly translated, lying in wait. The common association of childbirth with pain, death, and woe in general is not biblical. It is a state of mind conditioned by imperfect translators, which in turn can be attributed to the apostasies, flawed views of sexuality and marriage and women. Childbirth in the scriptures is primarily spoken of as a beautiful and blessed event. It is true that all of human life, including the bearing and raising of children, partakes more or less of the sorrows of the Edenic judgment. But this general condition of fallen humanity cannot invalidate the fact that children are a heritage of Yahweh and a reward, according to Psalm 127, verse 3. And since that is so, then it is surely reasonable that the means by which they are brought into the world, both conception and delivery, must also be a blessing. This passage in Genesis chapter 3 and a few others similarly deficient and inconsistent in their translations have supported a faulty Catholic theology to the effect that sexual intercourse in marriage is a necessary evil and should be only for the purpose of procreation. And that intense suffering in the act of childbearing is the just and reasonable punishment for sinful women. At one time it was even thought that a woman cries and screams in childbirth would please the ears of Elohim. And two women were once burned to death by the church in France. One for accepting a painkiller during childbirth, and the other for administering it. This according to E.S. Cowles, Religion and Medicine in the Church, page 18. On the other hand, it has never been considered necessary that men refrain from using labor-saving devices to elevate their sorrow of Adam's special curse in agriculture. He was allowed a tractor and a plow, no problem. Right. There are two biblical possibilities of vowels construction in the critical consonants that make up the phrase translated greatly increase. They are the consonants are HRBH and ARBH. You can see that the two words look the same. The only difference being the initial consonant. Translators usually assume that HRBH root is RBH, a verb meaning to be many. If this root is repeated here, we get the translation to be many, many, resulting in greatly multiply. But a small shift in the vowels from Rabbah to Arab in the second word changes the meaning entirely. Now it is not a repetition of RBH, but rather a new word, ARB. This word, Arab, occurs more than 30 times in the Tanakh. It means to lie in wait, to be ambushed. You see, Eve was ambushed by him who was lying in wait. If this second word is Arab and not the repetition of Rabbah, then the meaning would be he caused to increase the lying in wait, your sorrow. Rearranging that in English, Elohim says the one who ambushed you has multiplied your sorrow. That shows a totally different meaning. But it is the truth. What should we then read? A snare has increased your sorrow and your sighing. Thou art turning away to your husband, and therefore he will rule over you. Shama, your wife. Does this teaching, women must obey their husbands, agree with the general tenor of scriptural morals? Not at all. How do we know? From Abraham. Because Abraham once upon a time desired to maintain a polygamous household, and Sarah objected. Did Yahweh speak to her about this matter and say and said to her, remember Eve and the penalty? The desire shall be to your husband. No, he spoke to Abraham saying, in all that Sarah saith unto thee, the word is Shema, obey her voice. Yeah? Shema is to do and to obey. So Yahweh in Genesis 21 verse 12 did not say to Sarah, now listen, you are Abraham's wife and you have to be in subjection to him, so therefore you do as you're told. No, he told Abraham the reverse, and he said to Abraham, you must listen to all that your wife has to say and you must obey her voice. When Hannah, in the time of Samuel, when she could not deceive a child, her husband said to her, am I not better to thee than 10 sons? But Hannah did not obey the translator's teaching of Genesis 3:16. And Elohim blessed her in this sort of disobedience to her husband by sending her a son. Did Yahweh enforce the man-made rules of Genesis 3:16? He surely did not. But one quotation is sufficient to entirely destroy the fallacies and the faulty interpretations of Genesis 3:16. And that's the well-known golden rule uttered by Yeshua the Messiah. Whatever you would that men should do to you, do ye even so unto them. Well, we have never yet found the man who longed to be ruled by the will of his wife. All men led by the Spirit of Messiah obey this golden rule, which sets at defiance the so-called law of Genesis 3:16, as interpreted by these false translators. So who is responsible for the fall of humankind? According according to the wisdom of Ben Sira, 25:24, he says, for a woman is the beginning of sin, and because of her, we all died. But the scriptures in 1 Corinthians 15:27 says, for as in Adam all died, even so in Messiah all shall be made alive. Ben Sira says it's because of woman, but the scripture says it's because of Adam. And Job, in Job 31 verse 33 says, if I had covered my transgressions, and we know all what transgressions are, deliberately going against the rules of Yahweh, because that's what Adam did. If I covered my transgressions as Adam, by hiding my iniquity in my bosom. So who, according to Job, transgressed? Adam. Because Adam was not deceived. Eve was thoroughly deceived. She disobeyed the Torah by deception. But Adam, he stood there with his eyes wide open. That's why Job says, if I have covered my transgressions as Adam. But the woman, being deceived, fell into transgression. 1 Timothy 2:14. So why is the woman blamed for the fall? Up until around 2000, or up until 200 or 300 BC, she was not. It was during the time between the Old and the New Testaments that these changes came. Adam knew what was happening, and he chose neither to warn the woman nor to stop her from eating, and he chose to eat himself. It was Adam who was told to keep and guard the garden, yet he let the tempter come in and made no move to make him leave. Many theologians believe that Adam had begun something of a slip from fellowship with Elohim before the fall. Supporting evidence would include the fact that he never chose to eat from the tree of life, and that he allowed Satan to enter into the garden. Adam heard the whole conversation, and he never said a word to stop Satan. He was not deceived. He knew exactly what Satan was doing, yet he allowed his wife to eat, and then he ate. Did he watch to see what happened before he ate? We don't know. We only know that he ate, fully knowing what he was doing. And then the scripture says, Genesis 3:23 and 24, therefore Elohim sent him, who? Adam, out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. So Elohim sent him out of the garden. Now Eve, if you turn away from Yahweh and you follow your husband who I've just sent out of the garden, right, he will rule over you. You have a choice. You're going to stay here with me, and hopefully we see that Adam will repent, because Eve repented, because Eve was promised a redeemer to send straight that what happened. He says, I will put enmity between your seed. She knew that a Messiah, a redeemer, was going to come to set all this straight. She was the first woman to believe in redemption. And he sent him out of the garden to till the ground, which was cursed for his sake. Thou art turning away to thy husband, and he will rule over you. Therefore, El's warning to Eve. The New Testament teaches us that he that committeth sin is of the devil. Whosoever is born of Elohim does not commit sin. In this, the children of Elohim are manifested, and the children of the devil. 1 John 3, verse 8 to 10. These are harsh words. Those who deliberately keep on sinning are the children of the devil. Who sinned deliberately in the garden? Adam. Eve repented. But there is no inference that Adam repented at this time, for he was expelled from the garden. What must have happened after this? Before Cain could have been born, Genesis 4:1, either Adam must have repented and became again the child of Elohim, or Eve must have turned from Elohim and followed Adam out of the garden. The fact that Cain was a murderer certainly argues that Eve followed Adam. Had Adam repented and Eve stayed in the garden, maybe he would have gone back into the garden and all would have been well. That's not how it went. She followed him. Eve was then the first woman to forsake her heavenly kindred for her husband. She reversed Elohim's marriage law. This is very important. Therefore shall a man forsake his father and mother and cleave to his wife. So the husband leaves the parents and goes to the wife. Not the other way around. Can you imagine how much better this would in today's society if the husband moved in with the wife and the wife's family? At least the wife's family could protect her to a large degree. That was, you take Jacob. Jacob moved out of his parents' place and he stayed with his in-laws. And the in-laws protected the daughters. Had Eve remained steadfast with Elohim, Adam might, through the double influence of Elohim and Eve, have returned to Elohim. The marriage may have been consummated by Adam, the husband, forsaking the devil, his father, and cleaving to his wife, thus returning, like the prodigal, to the Heavenly Father's home. Who leaves to go for his bride? Messiah comes and leaves his chamber to go to his bride. Yahweh spoke warningly to Eve at this time, telling her that she was inclining to turn away from himself to her husband, and telling her that if she did, so her husband will rule over her. The correct rendering of the next passage in Genesis 3:16 is, "Thou art turning away to thy husband, and he shall rule over you." Makes perfect sense and is correct. Women in the Torah of Yahweh. Because this teaching has infiltrated all facets of religion, including Messianic Israelitism. So Hilkiah the priest and Ahikam, Achbor and Stephan and Asia went unto Huldah the prophetess. Oh, I thought that women were not allowed to say anything. And here Yahweh has women as prophets to proclaim his word to Israel. And they went for her advice. But we just learned that they're only good for sex and childbearing. Right? Who would consult a woman? She doesn't know anything. Well, the Torah says she has wisdom. Though it is not uncommon to read a victory hymn in the Hebrew scriptures, the Song of Deborah stands out as a unique in that it is a hymn that celebrates a military victory helped by two women. Remember when we saw this virtuous woman? They're like an army. Yahweh did not create them just to wash the dishes and to get men's slippers and to be subordinated into timid little unmoving beings. He has created them to win victories, to teach his people to stand together with men and be the image of Yahweh himself. When the male translators dealt with Phoebe, they had a choice. Do we make Phoebe a servant, thus in line with our views where women should be in the assembly? We surely cannot make her a deacon. That's too much authority. And we surely cannot make her a minister. That would leave too much room. Why? She might have been an elder, a prophetess, a pastor, or an apostle. No way. We make her a servant. Because that suits their purpose. But El, our Elohim, calls women. The word servant is the word diakonos, from which we get our word deacon. Strong's Concordance states that the general understanding of the meaning of this word was a Christian pastor or teacher. It can mean minister, servant, or deacon. Paul used it as a derivative of the word 34 times. 6 times it is clearly referred to the office of a deacon. 27 times it is translated minister. Only once, when Paul used the word, it is translated servant in describing this Phoebe. There it is, diakonos, Christian teacher or pastor. What does the scripture say? Joel 2 verse 28. Your daughters shall prophesy. Therefore, preach, Sister Phoebe, with all your being. Prophesy, Sister Phoebe, with all your might. Teach, Sister, with all diligence. Evangelize, bless, and minister to the assembly of the world, that your light so shine, so that all may see the grace of Yahweh. And we speak to the shackles of religion that have reduced the gifting of women in the name of Scripture, to the powers of darkness that have placed cultural bondage over El's creation, to the tyranny of the prideful men. Chains be broken, prison doors open, in the name of Yahweh, and according to his word, let the wonderful Elohim given, unstained, untainted, blood-bought truth set you free. Elohim's ultimate plan for women is that they serve their husbands. How sad that so many men view women from a selfish perspective. This view is often promoted by misreading the accounts of Eve's creation in Genesis 2, 18 to 25, in which Adam is provided a helpmate. The Hebrew word used here often is translated companion, denoting intimacy and partnership. But through the centuries it has been used to imply that Eve was some type of domestic appendage. And men have assumed that Elohim gave Eve to fulfill Adam's sexual needs, as well as to serve him as his cook, laundry maid, and so on. But the Genesis account does not say this. After Eve's creation, Elohim did not tell her, "You are Adam's helper. I command you to serve him well." She was not created for servitude. She was fashioned to be a co-laborer with Adam, so that they might rule together over creation, as Elohim commissioned them to do in Genesis 1, verse 28. Woman can't be fulfilled or spiritually effective without a husband, it claims. Well, from the time she was released from the German death camp in 1944 until her death in 1983, one of my countrywomen, Corrie ten Boom, taught the world about the Savior who could forgive the cruelest Nazi. Yet she never married. Did the fact that she did not have a husband make her any less complete? Now, let's not make any misunderstanding. The commandment in the Torah is that man and wife are to marry and to go forth and multiply. That's the command. But does the Apostle Paul also not say those who marry do good and those who do not marry do better in relation to serving Yahweh? If I wanted to serve Yahweh completely and totally, I tell you, my life would be much easier if I just had a mobile bus, my computer and my projector, and for the rest I had nothing to worry about. Bill, there is a rat, the cat born in a dead rat. Can you go and get this? Can you go and do that? I can't reach this. Can you do such? You haven't mowed the lawn. Why don't you help me wash the window? Much easier. I can just concentrate on Yahweh's work. It is true. In that regard, it's better not to marry. But it is not what Yahweh intends generally for man and wife, because they have to marry and bring forth children to populate the world and to give Yahweh subjects that they can worship and glorify his name. We have preached that a woman's primary responsibility is to find a godly husband, have lots of babies, and stay home to raise them for Messiah. And in the assembly, you sit in the back row and you keep your mouth shut, and you only learn from your husband. Right? That's what the New Testament says. Well, does it? I'm going to read you in a minute how they have manipulated this. Because they started already with the scarves right at the curses of Eve. But marital status is not a qualifier for ministry. The Bible does not even state whether certain key followers of Yeshua, such as the 12 disciples, were married or not. The highest calling of all believers, married or unmarried, is to develop a relationship with Yahweh and with Yeshua. So, ladies, you develop your own relationship with Yahweh and Yeshua, right? Because by grace you are also saved through faith, that not of yourself, it is a gift of Yahweh, that no one of us boasts. And you're not under the covering of your husband so that through him you may be saved. No, Yeshua saves you. There is only salvation in Yeshua the Messiah, Yahweh himself. Yahweh is the Redeemer of Israel and Israel's King. Women must not teach or preach to men in the assembly. Well, here we are, you see. 1 Timothy 2, verse 12. Well, I've got a book here, and I want to quote you some of the passages, because I don't believe in reinventing the wheel. And this is a book called Misquoting Jesus, and it's written by a fellow called Bud D. Ehrman. And he writes in his book on page 180, he comes up with a quotation of Galatians 3:27-28, which says, "For as many of you are as were baptized in Messiah, have put on Messiah. There is neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free, there is not male or female, for all of you are one in Messiah Yeshua, right? So that's a quotation from the Apostle Paul in Galatians 3:27-28. We all know it very well. Then, according to the translators, in 1 Timothy 2:11 to 15, it says, "Let a woman learn in silence with full submission. I permit no woman to teach and to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing." You see, your salvation is in childbearing. Excuse me? This is 1 Timothy 2:11 stating that woman's salvation is in childbearing. That's totally contrary to the scriptures, right? But we'll come to that in a minute. "Provided they continue in faith and love and holiness and modesty," right? What's happened that there is no difference all of a sudden? "There is neither Jew nor Greek, nor slave nor free, there is no male nor female, for all are one in Messiah." All are one. But here you're not allowed to say anything, and you have to... This doesn't make sense, does it? In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33, it says, "For Elohim is not an Elohim of confusion, but of shalom. As in all the churches of the saints, let the woman keep silent, for it is not permitted for them to speak, but to be in subjection, just as the law says." Can you show me from the Torah where it says this? I can't find it. "But if they wish to learn anything, let them ask their own husbands at home. For it is shameful for a woman to speak in the assembly. What did the word go forth only from you? Or has it reached you alone? No one doubts, however, that the Apostle Paul wrote 1 Corinthians. But there are doubts about this passage. For as it turns out, the verses in question, verse 34 and 35, are shuffled around in some form of our important textual witnesses in three Greek manuscripts and a couple of Latin witnesses. They are found not there at all." Oh. "In three Greek manuscripts and some other Latin witnesses, they find that these words are not there at all. They are certainly not in other manuscripts after verse 33, but later after verse 40. This has led some scholars to surmise that these verses were not written by Paul, but originate as a kind of marginal note added by a scribe, possibly under the influence of 1 Timothy chapter 2. The note was then inserted in different places of the text by various scribes, some placing the note after verse 33 and others placing it after verse 40. Okay, so what's happening here is that we have the original writing of Paul in 1 Corinthians 14, which does not have those verses I just read. Then we get a scribe who is working on this manuscript, and he writes it as a side note. On the side of the manuscript is a note, not in the text, but as a note. And then later on, when they translate it again, they take those notes on the side and they write them into the text. Because if you reread this, 1 Corinthians 14, take the verses out, it reads absolutely perfectly, right? But then if you insert these verses, you can see that it doesn't fit. Doesn't fit at all. Okay. Why we also know that it doesn't fit is that because Paul contradicts himself. For earlier in the book, as we have already noticed, Paul gives instructions to women to speak in the assembly according to chapter 11. And he says, when they pray and prophesy, how can this be? In chapter 11 he says, now listen ladies, when you pray or prophesy, you must do X, Y, Z, right? And then in chapter 14 he says, excuse me, you're not allowed to say anything in the church. If you want to know something, you ask your husband at home. How do you work that out? In chapter 11 you're allowed, and in chapter 14 you're not allowed anymore. That's because it has been changed. Now, I want you to understand one thing, that these people change things deliberately. And deliberately, one of the deliberate changes is in the book of Acts, where they talk about this person, Junia. And we might consider briefly several other textual changes of a similar sort. One occurs in the passage I've already mentioned in Romans 16, in which Paul speaks of a woman, Junia, and a man who was presumably her husband, Andronicus, both of whom he calls foremost amongst the apostles in verse 7. This is a significant verse because it is the only place in the New Testament in which a woman is referred to as an apostle. Interpreters have been so impressed by the passage that a large number of them have insisted that it cannot mean what it says, and so have translated the verse as referring not to a woman named Junia, but to a man named Junias. J-U-N-I-A-S, who along with his companion Androcinus is praised as an apostle. The problem with this translation is that whereas Junia was a common name for a woman, there is no evidence in the ancient world that Junias is even the name of a man. So in that culture there was no such name as Junias as a man, but there was definitely the name Junia for a woman. Now there are other prominent women, but to stick to, not only did they do this in this particular Romans 16 verse 7, but then they changed the structure of what was written. Some scribes also had difficulties with ascribing apostleship to this otherwise unknown woman. And they made a very slight change in the text to circumvent the problem. In some of our manuscripts, rather than saying greet Andronicus and Junia, my relatives and fellow prisoners, who are foremost amongst the apostles, the text is now changed so as to be more readily translated, greet Andronicus and Junia, my relatives, full stop. And also, greet my fellow prisoners, who are foremost amongst the apostles. See, then the fellow prisoners become the apostles, but this husband and wife are not. Just by putting different commas and different, you know. So we give you now the impression that it is the prisoners who are the apostles, but not this woman. That's how devious this is. A similar change was made by some scribes who copied the book of Acts. And in chapter 17 we learn that Paul had his missionary companion Silas spend some time in Thessalonica preaching the gospel of Messiah to the Jews in the local synagogues. They are told in verse 4 of Acts chapter 17 that the pair made some important converts. And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas and did a great many of the and did make great many of pious Greeks, along with a large number of prominent women, it says. But the idea of women being prominent, let alone prominent converts, was too much for some scribes. And so the text came to be changed in some manuscripts. So they were now told, and some of them were persuaded and joined with Paul and Silas, as did a great many of pious Greeks, along with a large number of wives of prominent men. Now it is the men who are prominent and not the wives. Can you see how this agenda, which started with the formation of these curses of Eve, have perpetrated right into the translation of the New Testament, and particularly in relation to women and women's position in the congregation of Yahweh? Because from the scriptures it's clear, Yahweh had women as prophets preaching and teaching the congregation of Israel. The most common mistake we make in biblical interpretation occurs when we take one isolated verse and build a doctrine around it, even if the verse seems to contradict other passages. This is often what we do with 1 Timothy 2:12. I do not allow women to teach or exercise authority over men. And if you go into the history of all this, it's very easily found out why this is. Most theologians believe that this passage was addressing an isolated case in Ephesus. They came to this conclusion after studying myriads of references in the Bible to women in spiritual authority. The Tanakh records that Deborah was a judge over all Israel, and Elohim blessed her leadership in battle, which we just saw. Other women who held authority over men included Miriam, Huldah, and Naadiah. Yeshua issued his first gospel commission to women. And both men and women were empowered to preach on the day of Pentecost. Your daughters shall prophesy. Joel chapter 2 verse 28. Priscilla, Chloe and Phoebe were leaders in the early assembly, and one woman, Junia, is called an apostle by the apostle Paul in Romans 6 verse 7. Although men translated the scriptures, changed their name. I want to show you a couple more mistranslations in relation to women. Isaiah 3 verse 12. As for my people, children are their oppressors and women rule over them. See how terrible. We've come so low in society that women rule over us. The nation could not sink any lower than to pass under woman rulers. Isaiah 3 verse 12. What should it be? As for my people, tax gatherers glean them and exhorters rule over them. Now if you read the whole passage in context, that makes perfect sense. And the women and children does not make any sense at all. Here we go. Children and women. The word translated children in this verse in Isaiah is a plural masculine verb to glean, abuse, or practice. Also, the word translated woman, two words without rabbinical vowel points, are exactly the same. So, you take one word it means exactos, but if you put the vowel pointing in, it means women. So they just put one vowel pointing in and made it women instead of these tax collectors. Because that was actually what was happening. They were fleecing the people. Exactly what's happening today. So tax collectors and robbers and stealers are ruling over us, as they do today. Had nothing to do with women and children. Psalm 68:11. King James Version. Yahweh gave the word. Great was the company of those that published it. Darby's Bible. Yahweh shall give the word to them that preach good tidings with great power. American Standard Version. Yahweh gave the word to women to publish the tidings are a great host. Yahweh gave the word to women who proclaimed it. It was a great company. You see how the other two tried to hide who he gave the word to and who was doing the proclaiming? Because women are to be silent, right? You're not allowed to say anything. And if you want to know something, you ask your husband at home. And make sure that you cover your head, because you must not be under his covering, otherwise you can't be saved. Women proclaimed the word of Yahweh. Women preached the word of Yahweh. Therefore we had women preachers. Right? Nothing wrong with that. The spirit of the Torah. The teaching that women must be perpetually kept silent in the assembly, be obedient to their husbands, and never presume to teach or preach because Eve sinned, blights the doctrine of the atonement and robs Messiah of his glory. In that his death atoned for all sin, including Eve's. Not just Adam's, including Eve's. It is entirely contrary to the spirit of the Torah. The acceptance of penance, to walk around with headscarves, subdued under your husband, having to be... The acceptance of penance or punishment is to deny the sufficiency of Yeshua's atonement for our sin. I say this again. To accept the acceptance of penance or punishment is to deny the sufficiency of Yeshua's atonement for our sin. What does Romans 8 verse 1 say? It is certain that women were not, as theologians have claimed, subordinate to man from the day Eve sinned. History proves that the subordination was gradually brought about by men themselves and was not accomplished for hundreds of years. It is certain that no one syllable can be found in the Tanakh ordering women to keep silent in the Israelite public assemblies. And it would be astounding, since women were not silenced under the Old Covenant, if it were true that they were silent for the sins of Eve now in the New Covenant. The very heart of the teaching, which is, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Messiah Yeshua. There is therefore no condemnation for those male and female who are in Messiah Yeshua. Look at this. The congregation of Israel, a religious body called by Elohim out of bondage and into the wilderness, was certainly an assembly. Indeed, Stephen spoke of this assembly in the wilderness in Acts chapter 7 verse 38. The very first note of praise raised to Elohim in that assembly was responded to by Miriam and her women with trimble and dance. Miriam, the prophetess, and why should she have been called by the inspired word the prophetess, if Elohim had never and did never use her voice to declare his will to Israel. Elohim gives no empty lying titles. And this woman prophetess was one of the three great leaders of whom Yahweh said, I brought thee out of the land of Egypt, and I sent before thee Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Micah 6, verse 4. Did Paul silence women? It was not until after women had brought the Redeemer into the world, not until after she had given her testimony to the most important facts in the Messianic faith and convinced the early disciples of their truth, not until long after Paul's day, when the grievous wolves, and I've spoke of them before, had entered the flock, as Paul said they would in Acts 20 verse 29, and wrested Paul's language, as Peter said that they did in 2 Peter 3 15 to 16, that the teaching arose that Paul had silenced women, veiled them, and made them subordinate to men. Because there is freedom for all. So if you are in any religious system where you have no freedom, you know that you are in the wrong place. Now Yahweh is spirit, and where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is freedom. 2 Corinthians 3:17. And that because of the false brethren privilege brought in, who came in privately to spy out our freedom, which we have in Messiah Yeshua, that they might bring us into bondage. Galatians 2 verse 4. With freedom did Messiah set us free. Stand fast therefore, and be not entangled again in a yoke of bondage. Galatians 5 verse 1. For you, brothers, having been called to freedom, only do not use freedom as an occasion for the flesh, but through love serve one another. Not the wife just serve the husband, but we must serve one another. Galatians 5 verse 3. How many mediators does the woman need? Does she need her husband to mediate? Not according to 1 Timothy 2:5, for there is one Elohim, and there is one mediator between Elohim and man and women, the man Yeshua, the Messiah. Brothers and sisters in Yahweh, I hope that this has helped you. I also hope that this has helped the people who are listening and have asked me to put this on the website. I think of the people in England who are struggling at the moment with certain of these issues. Please do not take my word for it, but go to the scriptures and work it out for yourself. And then you will come to the conclusion that both men and women are equal before Yahweh. That Yahweh created the human, that he parted them in half, made one part male and one part female. And when they come together, they are human. Therefore, we can only be human together. And Yahweh commanded the man and the wife to come together and bring forth offspring to the glory of Yahweh. And this offspring is brought forth as a gift that Yahweh gives to man and wife. And she has the privilege of motherhood to bring up the children in wisdom, as we read, because wisdom will come from her lips as she instructs her children from the Torah to the glory of Yahweh. And men, let us be clear not to oppress our women, because it is oppressing part and parcel of the image of Yahweh. That we must treat her with respect, as the scriptures point out. And I ask and pray that women will take their full position in Yahweh, become teachers and preachers of his word, so that they may testify to the full of the glory that Yahweh has given to us all, Yeshua HaMessiah, in whose name we pray. Abba Yahweh, we thank you and we praise you for your word. And Father, may the truth is, we will be set free, so that we may be free indeed to go out in this world and to testify of you, of your wondrous ways, and of your wondrous Torah. And Father, as this age is coming to a close, I thank you that this Shavuot again you showed us to repent, to be baptized in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, so that then you can come with your Ruach HaKodesh and infill us, so that at the Feast of Trumpets these dead bones may live, so that you can birth your people, protect them in Goshen until they are ready to return to the land to build you a house. Father, we pray, will you hasten that day. Honor and glory be to your name, now and always. Amen.